Welcome to Kara's Cures, where we explore the cutting edge of wellness. Well, we often hear we need to have a meditation practice, but that's been hard for a lot of folks. So this is the interview for you if you've been struggling with that. Do you feel like you can't meditate? One of America's top life coaches says we can just stop trying. Daniel Mangena talks about what to do instead to create calm and the life you want. Welcome, Daniel.
Hey, how you doing?
We're good. So, you know, a lot of us are hearing about the benefits of meditation practice. I, some years ago, in doing Kara's Cure, started it because everyone told me, oh, you're not meditating, you need to. But you kind of have a different take that if people are feeling like meditation is one more thing to do, that maybe that is not creating great change for them.
Well, I think this really comes down to, Kara, this whole concept of recognizing that we're not just energy beings or not just an emotional state. We're a physical body, and we also have a mental experience that we have too. And in order to create what we want, we need to have all of those in harmony and balance. If someone's pushing, resisting against, or just not aligned with traditional meditation, then that can actually create disconnect in the mind, some kind of cognitive dissonance that stops them being able to move forward. So getting to the meditative state, there are different ways that we can do that, but we also need to consider all the other aspects of ourselves and how those contribute to the outcomes that we want.
Yes. And in fact, maybe we just throw out the word meditation, because really the point of it is to be in the moment. And you're saying we could do that by maybe we're exercising, or maybe we're taking the kids or our whole, if we're really good at it, I guess our whole life would be being right here in this moment.
Which is a big part of my work. It's encouraging people to connect with that ongoing state of presence so that they don't have to go into a special practice in order to attain it. Now, we're human. That's not going to be possible all the time for all of us, but we can certainly attain more presence in our life if we're not obsessing about one particular thing and they're not doing it anyway.
I think people will be inspired by your story. You had a late diagnosis of Asperger's. You had severe trauma at 20 that actually led to suicidal thoughts. Tell me a little bit about your story and how it led you to now coach people all over America to improve their lives.
Well, the thing is that I personally was so caught up in the loss of identity, the loss of meaning of self, when everything was lost, everything was pulled away from me. That brought me to a place where I said, well, I don't actually have anything left to contribute to the world. I don't have anything that I'm worth. And it was actually clawing my way back from that, learning to develop a self-love, learning to develop a relationship with myself, which culminated in, of course, my diagnosis with Asperger several years later, that helped me to develop a new identity based on me, my choices, and who I am. But getting there wasn't just reading books. Getting there wasn't just meditating. Getting there just wasn't watching a mind movie or looking at a vision board. It was taking a holistic approach to learning myself, what I want to be, where I am, and how to get there.
So you've developed a system. It's called the Beyond Intention Paradigm. I think people were so busy, they like to know steps, and you've got four steps. Let's talk about those.
Four steps. So coming on my journey, the really funny thing is that people often ask me, you know, what was the big moment when you decided you don't want to commit suicide anymore? And you know what? There wasn't a big moment. It was just kind of waking up one day and realizing that, hang on a minute, I've been choosing life for a little while now. I'm actually doing something new. I'm building myself back up. I was in a happy relationship and things were actually working out. And in that moment, I took a look back and looked at the journey that I'd come through. And there were these specific areas that had shifted, changed, and that I'd moved through. And the first of these was actually the moment, interestingly enough, when I went to go and commit suicide. And I realized that I didn't have the resources or the know-how to pull it off immediately and definitely. In fact, I had such little self-belief that I thought if I tried to commit suicide, I was going to fail. And that was actually one of the key points that actually stopped me actually even making an attempt. It was having such little self-belief that I didn't think that I would actually be able to pull it off. But in that moment, there was a seed that became a kernel, that became a sprout, that became the tree of what I do now. And that's something that I call the common denominator theory. You see, I understood that I couldn't depend on someone else in order to achieve this. I couldn't rely on someone else in order to get beyond it either. It was all going to come down to me. And the math behind that is very simple. If we've got 20 different relationships that we've got in our life, okay, we can go and individually try and change everyone. But if we change ourselves, then the substance of every single one of those relationships must change to some degree. So common denominator theory and accepting that responsibility is the foundation to everything. So that's step one. Step number two is this whole thing we've been talking about, presence. When we're caught up in the past, when we're caught up in the future, we're not present enough to make the changes that are actually going to bring something different in our life. We're going to be caught in the same loop that's creating the same outcomes, making the same choices, having the same thoughts, the same emotions. So step two is about the practical work of healing from the past and healing from the obsession with futures that we don't want, so we can be present to make new choices. From there, we can start to develop a conscious expectation, a positive expectation of what we want. I teach that through gratitude for something that hasn't happened yet. There's actually a lot of science that shows that gratitude for something in advance actually changes the neurology of the brain and allows you to change the habits and behaviors that you're doing, so you can actually bring the outcome into your life. And the last step is listen. And this is probably my favorite, because I think all too often when we're talking about meditation, spiritual practice, manifesting, abundance, and all these beautiful topics, we can lose sight of the fact that we are human. We're not going to be switched on all the time. We're not going to get it right. We're not always going to be happy. We're not always going to be smiling. Some days we'll be sad. Some days we'll get it switched on, and some days we won't. Listen is about honoring that, having compassion for ourselves, tuning in and listening to what's going on so we can course correct when we do come off course.
So you're the creator of a program called Micro to Millions, also best-selling author of Stepping Beyond Intention, and you host your podcast, Do It with Dan. Mm. But I think financial things are something that really stress people out. And I know, especially with the pandemic, these unexpected things happen. You lose a job, or even just something unexpected, like your car breaks down, and people start to spiral. In a practical way, what would you do to help people get back on track when they have a lot of fear going in their life? Maybe it's about finances.
Yeah, unfortunately, one of the most catastrophic things, apart from the sad loss of life with this pandemic, is that there's been such turmoil and uncertainty, and that's basically put people in such a terrible position. I know in the US, for example, there's been a lot of support from the government for businesses and small businesses. They can keep people employed, that they can actually still grow and survive. But it's, you know, we're dealing with a pandemic. This is unprecedented. We've not been in this situation before. And so it's very challenging for so many people, mentally, emotionally, and also physically. What I would say the first thing to do is to accept that we're not going to be able to be certain in these times. I think a lot of people get into a state of stress because they're trying to develop a level of control over these circumstances. But that's just not something that we're probably going to be able to see. So getting comfortable with the discomfort that we're in is a very powerful step in order to be able to start then bringing in the resources, the support, and making the new choices that are going to allow you to navigate this time.
So let's break that down a little. What does that look like to be uncomfortable with something that's causing discomfort? Like, I think our reaction is to just resist it, stop it, fix it. And that's not what we should be doing.
It's not that we shouldn't be doing it. It's just the obsession with that is just going to put you back into a state of a downward spiral. So if we go back to my definition of anxiety, and of course, this isn't my specialist area, but anxiety, as I define it, is going to a future that we don't want and bringing that emotional state back to the present moment. So I'm scared that this is going to happen. I'm scared that this is going to get worse. I'm then caught up in that. But guess what? Then the thinking, the choices, the actions that I make now are going to be tied to that fear because it's been so overwhelming. Instead of me saying, okay, that might happen, but it might not happen. Based on what's available to me now, what resources do I need to be able to deal with the worst that can happen? How can I start to prepare myself in case something else happens? I can't resource myself for the different potentials in the future if I'm locked in one fearful one and acting from that place instead.
So you coach a lot of people, and I'm sure we're all humans. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of the similar things. Like, what are some practical steps that people can do? What do you tell your clients, and how are they overcoming some of this with practical things we can start inserting in our life?
The first thing is start to bring some focused attention to things that are actually going right. And as much as that sounds kind of cheesy and a little bit cliched, the bottom line is that the reticular activating system in the brain is going to focus on what we're giving more attention to. I'm not talking about putting your head in the sand either. I'm just saying, let's create some balance between things that are actually going right. Let's look at the support that we do have. Let's look at the positive options that we do have. Let's look at the fact that we do still have the opportunity to do something different. That just starts to balance out the ship and give us the opportunity to start opening up to some new options, opening up to some new choices. That is a foundational principle that I think will support people in being able to actually tap into those and doing something different and getting a different outcome.
Right, that makes sense. And you talked a lot about acceptance, the idea that we just kind of have to accept what's going on. And that doesn't mean that we don't want to change it, but in the first moments, we would just actually accept things just as they are and say, okay, this is happening.
There's a difference between acceptance and resignation. It's not, oh, this is happening, oh, well, it's the end of the world. It's, this is happening, okay, what can I do about it? What support can I bring in? How can I team up with people? How can I help others? But none of that can happen unless I'm present to and accepting of what is right now.
As you're coaching people now, and you were lucky enough to be named one of the top coaches by the Wall Street Journal, is there a theme of what people are really struggling with right now and that you can advise our viewers, sort of some armchair free advice?
Yeah, here's one. It's recognizing, I love to call people back to nature, and I just would love to leave this thought with everyone. When you look at nature, nature never is in lack. Nature's never in need. The only time nature goes out of balance is when we humans come and mess things up. When we remember that we are a part of nature too, and that actually there is available to us that natural state of abundance also, we can start coming from things at things from a different place. So instead of coming at things from not being enough, we can start to approach things from, okay, is there a possibility that there is something here? Is there a possibility I do have some resources? Just opening up to the possibility that the positive side of something is available to us changes the game in terms of the choices, actions, and decisions and behaviors that we happen to have in the moment.
And tell the folks out there where they can get some more information. I know that you are coaching folks and you've written some books. Where would you like people to start?
Dreamwithdan.com is always the easiest place to get everything about me. Books, podcasts, everything is there. Dreamwithdan.com.
All right, Daniel Mangena, we're going to stop just sitting there and meditating, although that's very nice and peaceful. Thank you for giving us permission to do something else. That's hard for you out there.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for coming on Kara's Cures.